OK. So, we continue. So, today is the fourth session of the second semester on this class about Burnside type results on fusion category and on fusion ring and on hypergroup. We are still in the review part, as I explained yesterday on the WeChat group. We are in the review part. So we will review all what we did last semester as quickly as possible. So we will not reread everything except the proof. Sometimes I can try to catch some idea, but otherwise I will go as quickly as possible. And when we will have finished all the slides from last semester, we will go much slower. I will write the new slides during the class. So it will, and we will go into all the details, but we are still in the review part. So don't worry if you did not attend the last semester. And you want to go into much details, you have two possibilities. You can watch the video of last semester corresponding to this class. You can just repair the, you can consider the page. For example, you have a page here. And you can see, okay, today, la, la, last, yesterday, we went from the page, I don't remember, 50 to the page 70, 78. So you can go to last semester video, which is available on the BIMSA web page of last semester class, and you can watch the video corresponding to this page between 50 and 78 and watch in details. Or you can also, alternatively, you can read the corresponding preprint paper where all the details are written. You can do both also. Okay, so yesterday we finished with this kind of result. Yesterday we finished by we discussed about group-like elements in a hypergroup, group-like element in the dual, and we said that the notion of group-like element in a hypergroup or in a fusion ring, if you like, or a fusion category is something which work as a group. It's a basic element of a fusion ring or a standard element of a hypergroup or a simple object of a fusion category, which work exactly as a group. So when you multiply two such elements, it's still an element in the basis or in the etc. And what we observe finally is that if you have some group like, if you multiply a group like by something which is not group like, you are still in the basis. Here it was in the dual, but it's work in general. So the group like event act on the basis. Okay, so this is what we said. We finished by that yesterday. Okay, so this is the last, and we will provide the dual version of this one and of this one. So the dual, the set of group-like algebra morphism. Non, le groupe like linear caractère, the set of group like linear caractère is a group under this assumption. We will provide the dual version of that and of that, the action. Okay, dual version of that as follow. Okay, so proposition. You take an abelian normalizable hypergroup, so the normalizable with this linear caractère. such that the dual is real and negative, then the this is a group. So this is the set of normalized group-like elements in the basis. Normalized. This is not in the dual. So this is a group, okay. Moreover, so this corresponds to this part. And for this part, you have the action. Moreover, the left multiplication like that permutes the basis. So in other words, it acts on the basis. It permutes the element of the basis. So this matrix is a permutation matrix. Okay. So it's okay. Now, suppose, so the same kind of assumption we did before, we suppose that one or that one. So you suppose you have an abelian normalizable hypergroup. You suppose it is real negative and this is Frobenius per dimension linear character. Or you suppose the dual of that is real negative, one or the other. Then you can deduce all this result. And in fact, this corollary is a summary of all the results from this subsection. So all this lemma and all this proposition can be reformulated like that. So it's a concentrate of all what we did in this subsection. So you have this assumption or this assumption, then this and this are both finite groups. So the set of group-like renormalized elements and the set of group-like linear character are finite. It's these two sets are finite groups. Okay. Then you have the action. So this is a matrix, permutation matrix, left multiplication operator normalized. And same for the dual. So this is also a permutation matrix for the left multiplication on the dual. Okay, so we have all what we can expect, what was proved. Okay, so now we will consider two elements. One is a product of the normalized basic element. The other is a product of the linear character. So this one called P, this one called P hat. And remember this, we are starting to get the kind of result, this kind of element we need, the result involving the result about arithmetic constraint on modular tensor category, etc., involve this kind of product. So we are close to this kind of arithmetic property. Okay, so you take an abelian normalizable hypergroup, you take a group-like element in the hypergroup. Okay, then you get that the application of this element of the dual to a normalized group-like element is plus or minus one. Okay, so I skip the proof. Again, I will check if I can catch some ID. If it just so. Here you just develop, apply the definition. You need the definition of the dual, of the adjoint in the dual. And you need the definition of group-like. So it's okay. You get that. And then you have a square equal to one. So you mean, if you don't apply the square, you will get plus or minus one. So there is no mystery here. Okay, so now, so let you take a group, abelian normalizable hypergroup, you take a group-like element, then, okay, so you call, Here you have plus or minus one. So you have a sign. So you call this the sign of xi. So this is the sign of this group like element. Okay. So it's okay, a sign, no problem. So you have the dual version of that. You apply this kind of result and definition to the dual. So you take an abelian normalized abelian group and you will consider the dual. So you take, consider a group like element in the dual. And then you get the same kind of result because so here you have the product inside. Here you get the product outside. Product here. Remember that in fact, this, when you identify the hypergroup with this double dual, this can be seen as the product, the evaluation map I di. It's exactly of this form. If you consider the dual as a usual hypergroup, this is exactly of the form I wrote here, but it's reformulated like that. So this, you have a dual flavor, but it's the same result. And you get similarly the sign of this linear character like that. Okay. So following the assumption of 237. So this assumption was, we are in page 81. So I guess this is the same kind of assumption. Yeah. You assume this or this, so it is real negative and Frobenius, or the dual is real negative. This kind of assumption. You take, okay. Consider a group like element of the hypergroup and in the dual. Then the sign defined before are just the determinant of the multiplication operator. Called the signature because these are permutation matrix. So the determinant of a permutation matrix is called the signature of the permutation. Okay. So yeah. So you need some decomposition. You use this basis for the so for the IP, you have this basis or this basis here. Use this basis. You may need abelian. I guess it is abelian. This isn't the basis because it's abelian. So, the primitive central is important to form a basis because it's abelian, etc. And so, etc. So, it should be okay. Okay. And, oh, so we have the last definition of the section. We can next go to section 3. A hypergroup is called perfect if it has no non-trivial group-like element. So we may not use this definition right now, but let me motivate this definition. So it generalizes the notion of perfect group. What is a perfect group? A perfect fusion ring. So a perfect group, such that this, so the commutant subgroup is the group itself. This is perfect group. And in fact, this property, so maybe you need generated, I don't remember. This property is equivalent to get that any irreducible character of degree 1 is trivial. In other words, the type, if you consider the fusion ring of the character ring, so the type of this character ring, which is the sequence of degree of the irreducible character, is 1, A, B, C, etc. V1 strictly less than A, less than equal to B, less than equal to C. So the type, the only one entry in the type is the linear, the type, the degree of the trivial character, trivial irreducible representation. So it means that every irreducible representation of the group of dimension one is trivial, which is equivalent to perfect. This is perfect group, perfect hypergroup for the same reason. To be of degree one is correspond to group like. So any is perfect if any non-trivial group like A. So it has no non-trivial group like A. Non-trivial element of degree one. Okay. So new section. And this section is conceptually interesting because it will talk about Galois theorem. So Galois symmetry for hypergroup. So you take an abelian rational hypergroup. Rational means the fusion coefficient are rational. You take the standard element. It is abelian, so you can decompose with the primitive central idempotent. And remember that in fact, the coefficient here are just the entry of the character table. So the value, you evaluate the standard element on the linear character. You define the field generated by all these entries of the character table. So it's called so here it's not one element but all the elements. The field obtained by extending Q by all these elements. Okay. So what about that? So this remark is saying that if you have two entries which are equal, so if you have two linear characters which have the same value on all the standard elements, then they are the same. Because, yeah, so this is trivial because this is completely defined because this is a basis. So if they are the same on all the elements of the basis, so they must be the same. So it means that if you, it means that in the character table, two colons cannot be the same. Two colons must be different. And in fact, we have the orthogonality relation. So two colons are orthogonal in some sense. Okay. I don't, we will use that somewhere, I don't remember. Orthogonality relation. Yeah. I'm not sure it really needs orthogonality relation. They are the same on the basis, so they must be the same. But yeah. A fortiori, the orthogonality relation there, that they must be the same. Otherwise, it will be non-zero. Anyway, so maybe we don't need that, or maybe we need that, I don't remember. Permutation of character. Okay, so you take an abelian rational hypergroup. For any linear character, you define an element in the Galois group. Okay, so here let me explain what is. So you have this one, which is algebraic closure of the field Q, and what is the letter, the name of that? Sigma. This sigma is an automorphism, a field automorphism, which is the identity on the field Q. So this is a Galois automorphism. So for any linear character and any Galois automorphism, you define a new linear character. So the Galois automorphism acts on the linear character. So we define a new linear function like that, and we will show it's a linear character. So you define it like that as follows. So you have What is the definition of that? So this is a map from H to C defined as follow. You define it on the basis, and in fact, you just define it like that, and you apply the Galois automorphism, which is just saying that you apply the linear, you apply the Galois automorphism on this column. And in fact, we will see that this will be another column of the linear character. So this is what we will state and what is proved here. For any abelian rational hypergroup, the function is an algebra map. So it means that the Galois group acts on the set of linear characters, act on the basis of the dual. And so, unfortunately, I have to skip the proof. But you see, the proof is quite long, but so this is conceptually interesting. You have to deal with Galois theory, but I have to skip. So you decompose. Okay. Here you just apply the definition, linearity, definition, linearity. You use the fact that it is identity on the rational because you really need the fusion coefficient to be rational, and so you can put it out and you get that. You use the fact that it's a field morphism, so it deals with addition and multiplication. So you get one thing. And so you prove that this is equal to that. Similarly, you compute that and you get the same thing here. So they are both equal. So it's an algebra map. Yeah. So you have the multiplication here, multiplication. And similarly, you want to prove something else. Here you want to prove it act. So if you act one time and another time, it's the same thing that you multiply here. So you get that equal that. Okay. So it's really a group action on the basis. And it is an algebra map. We have two properties. It's an algebra map, each act. Okay. Okay. So you can define a permutation. It acts on the basis, so it permutes the element of the basis. So for any Galois automorphism, you can define a permutation of the index set. Okay. And so you can reformulate this Galois, this result like that. It permutes the index of the linear character. So the action of the Galois automorphism acts, in fact, on the second index of the character table. Okay. So that's okay. Now, here it's a review of Galois extension. Okay, so you take an inclusion of field, a finite inclusion of field. A finite extension. So let A inclusion in B be field extension, a finite field extension, which means that B is a finite dimensional A vector space. So this extension is called normal if for all elements here, and any irreducible polynomial here with root alpha, then all the root are in B. Okay. So you consider the irreducible polynomial with coefficient in A, With a root alpha, maybe should be in B. Yeah, it should be in B. Otherwise, make no sense. Otherwise, you can just consider the algebraic closure of A. It might not be. So, if one root of an irreducible polynomial with coefficient in A, one root is in B, then all the roots should be in B. So it means normal. Now, separable. Mean all roots are distinct. So all the roots of this polynomial are different. It means separable. Okay, for irreducible, all irreducible polynomial here are distinct roots, and a Galois extension is an extension which is both normal and separable. Okay, so exercise. In characteristic zero, characteristic zero implies separable. So in characteristic zero, every irreducible polynomial has distinct root. Normal is equivalent to what? For all Galois automorphic, Galois normal is equivalent to be stable by any Galois automorphism for A. Normal. Because you assume A, you have one here, and so the image is always here, because the Galois automorphism are exactly defined as something which map a root to another root of an irreducible. So it's okay. Lemma: a finite extension is Galois if and only if for all. So here you have Q. The finite extension of the rational is Galois if and only for all Galois automorphism. Then the stable for all Galois automorphism. So in this case, because it's of characteristic zero, so it's separable, and you have this assumption is exactly this. So this lemma is an immediate consequence of these two exercises. Okay. So we only need to care about that to have Galois extension when you consider the rational. Okay, so you take an abelian rational hypergroup. You consider the Galois extension, the group ex, the field extension by the entry of the character table. And this should be, this correlates state that this is a Galois extension. So it states that. So this is exactly what we said here, in fact. It's okay. It's okay. So it's a Galois extension. Okay, so Galois extension mean you can define a Galois group, and I did not. You have a Galois group and any intermediate correspond to subgroup or something like that. I did not recall the result about Galois group, and anyway, so let's see if I state something somewhere. So, remark. You take the map, so Galois extension to the permutation. Galois automorphism. The permutation as it was defined before, then it is injective. So this is injective. If you have two same permutation, then you get the same two Galois automorphism. Okay, so it's, the proof is straightforward. Okay, so now you take an abelian rational hypergroup, you take a Galois automorphism for the extension given by the entry of the character table, then you take this permutation. Okay. So you, in fact, we will use it several times in the proof. So we just write it without index, but this is exactly the one for this choice. Then, in fact, this Galois automorphism permutes the formal codegree according to this permutation. Okay? Sorry. And the proof will use, as you can expect, the first orthogonality relation, which involves the formal codegree, and you will apply. You apply the Galois automorphism on this formula, and you get. So you apply, you get that. What we use here by definition. So HI is invariant because HI is a rational. So it's invariant by Galois automorphism. So you can put HI out, and you apply the first orthogonality relation again. Because you, so you get, so it's okay. L'hypergroup is H, it's called H integral if this is an integer. So for a general hypergroup, this is positive. Yeah. But for H integral, it should be a positive integer. Positive. So in the proof here, it was rational because the hypergroup was a rational hypergroup. So in particular, the fusion coefficients are rational, so this is rational. But in general, it may not be rational, but this is say this this definition says it should be positive integer. So H integral. Hypergroup. So this assumption will permit to prove some Burnside result. And I guess I already mentioned this in the introduction. Okay, so you take, this is a remark. So you consider hypergroup, normalizable hypergroup, where the linear character for the normalization is the Frobenius point dimension. And you take it to be the Grothendieck ring of a weakly integral fusion category. Weakly integral, remember that it's just seen that the global Frobenius power dimension is an integer. Or the global order is an integer here. Weakly integral. Then, this theorem of Victor Ostrich state that this should be an integer. So the formal codegree divide the global time from its parent dimension, which is very useful. In fact, I am using this result in a paper I am writing right now. Classify the for the classification of integral. Rank less than equal to 6. we can use this kind of property and this kind of property. In fact, for a fixed rank, you can have only finitely many fusion rings satisfying this property, which involve, in fact, because you have the sum of, you have this equal to one. This is an Egyptian fraction. And there is only finitely many possible Egyptian fractions for a given length, or for the rank, a given rank. You have finitely many such a sum. Okay. So we know this is an integer, and it divides this, so it's very useful. Okay. So, by equation 211. Where is equation 211? It's too far. Question 211 is too far. This equation. This equation, okay. So this mean, so Ostrich say you that for weakly integral fusion category, this is an integer, but this integer is just, this equation is the HI in the dual. So the HI in the dual is an integer. So the Grothendieck ring of a weakly integral fusion category, its dual is H integral. And in fact, we will prove result involving Bernstein for this case, and so it will have consequences for weakly integral fusion category. Okay. So you take an abelian normalizable hypergroup with H integral dual. So this is a short way to say the dual is H integral. So H integral dual means this is an integer in general, in this case. Then it is weakly integral. So here it's interesting. And in fact, this lemma, the proof of this lemma may, should be partly due to my co-author and myself, but also a discussion with Andrew Chopier, I guess. So this proof is partly due to Andrew Chopier. So you have the kind of converse. You start from something weakly integral, fusion category, of course, and you get the H integral dual. But if you have H integral dual, if you have H integral dual, you get weakly integral also. So this is strong. But of course, you have a weakly integral hypergroup, or if you like a weakly, if you consider a fusion ring, you have weakly integral fusion ring. But the converse is not true. If you start from a weakly integral fusion ring, it's not H integral dual. If you start for weakly integral fusion category, it's H integral dual. So H integral dual, again, is a categorification criterion. It's a necessary condition for getting a categorification. It's necessary, it's not sufficient. When I say categorification criterion, I say in the sense of necessary, not in the sense of sufficient. The sufficient condition for categorification of fusion ring, this does not exist. This is too strong. The difference between fusion ring and fusion category is very, very hard. You have to solve Pentagon equation, so you cannot get an easy criterion in the sense of sufficient. It's always necessary. Okay. So then it is weakly integral, so as I said. If it is rational, then, well, if it is rational, then these constants are invariant by the Galois automorphism permutation. Okay. Weakly integral do not imply rational, as exactly as weakly integral fusion ring are not integral fusion ring, because you can have dimension of square root of n, which when you can make the sum of the square, it's an integer, but it's not. Yeah, so same form. But if you have that, then it's also an integer. C'est invariant by Galois-Thomorphism. OK. So the profit there. So we already know that this is the order is invariant by dual. So you can write the order of the dual like the sum of this kind of things as an integer. So in a rational case, we already proved something before. Okay. And then you use, you get that. Okay. So if it, since it is H integral, so you assume it is H integral, so you assume this to be an integer. Okay, so I have no more idea to say, so the profit there. It's basically the consequence of all what we discussed before about Galois-automorphism. Okay, so new section. So I guess it's good to make the pause. That's the new section. So pause. Six. I will remove 1 minute because we take the pause in advance. So pause. Okay, so we finish the section about Galois theory. So new section. Bernstein's vanishing property for hypergroup. And now I'm feeling too hot. I have to So we are starting to in some sense, all the preliminary, what we need to start to talk about Bernstein property was done. Now we can start with Bernstein property and then all the theorem we want. Okay, so you take any hypergroup, you take an element in the basis, it will be called a vanishing element if there is a zero in its column on the character table, if you in some if you like, but because it's not necessarily abelian, we cannot properly talk about character table, but it means that there exists a linear character vanishing on this basic event. It's a vanishing element. Okay? Otherwise, it's called a non-vanishing element. So you can partition the basis between vanishing and non-vanishing, partition. Okay, so by a previous lemma, which is recalled here, so you get an abelian normalizable hypergroup. An element is group-like if and only if you have that for all linear characters. In particular, if you take this to be real non-negative, then it will be normalizable, then you can apply this lemma, and you get that the group-like elements are non-vanishing, because otherwise you will get a zero, it's a one, so it cannot vanish. Okay. So I was a little bit cheating here, because this lemma state abelian, but in fact, the part of the proof we need to get that do not need abelian, so we can state that inclusion, you only need to assume real and negative, you don't need abelian. Anyway, in the abelian case, since the primitive centroid and potent are bases, you can write the basic element like that with the character, the entry of the character table here. So this decomposition will be used later with this star. So it follows that if xi is non-vanishing, so xi is non-vanishing if and only if it is invertible in H. It's an invertible element in this algebra. So invertible, because invertible is equivalent to have non-zero determinant, but okay. So non-zero, so why it is non-zero determinant? So why non-vanishing mean non-zero determinant? So it may be explained here. Yeah, it's explained here. So let me just consider that. So it is strictly weaker than group-like. So what is strictly weaker than group-like? To be, yeah, to be non-invertible, to be invertible is strictly weaker than group-like. You can have invertible elements which are not group-like. Okay. So it means that so we have this equivalence, but this may be strict. Yeah. Okay. So it may be strict, but the Bernstein property precisely state that the non-vanishing are exactly the group-like. Okay. This is precisely the Bernstein property we will consider. So, okay. Ah. So why it is? So why non-vanishing imply so invertible imply non-vanishing? Okay. Ah, yeah. Because the determinant here is the product of the eigenvalue. In fact, this is correspond to the character table, and the character table is made by the simultaneous diagonalization of this kind of thing. And the determinant is a product of the eigenvalue. So if the determinant is non-zero, you cannot have a zero thing, so it must be non-vanishing. Okay. We have this equivalence. So that imply that B1, the set of non-vanishing elements, coincide with the standard element which are invertible in here. Okay. So invertible. Okay. So in fact, as I explained in the introduction, we classified, we found fusion ring with a non-zero determinant and L2 norm greater than one, which is exactly, we find an example of something which is trick here. The L2 norm greater than one means it's non-group-like, and determinant non-zero mean it's invertible. So we found an example of non-Bernstein. Okay. It was quite rare for a simple integral fusion ring. Okay. Okay. So now you can reconsider this kind of product we mentioned at the beginning of the section, the product of the linear character for any abelian normalized variable pair group. Okay. This is a dual version of that. Yeah, so he write this dual version of that. What do you mean? So what? Why we have this equality? Ah, no. Yeah. This is the definition of that. And this has an element of the dual decompose. This is the basis of the dual. And this is the coefficient of this basis. And P hat, don't you? P, yeah, P, okay. P is the product of the xi divided by di. P. And P hat is that. So why you have that? So maybe because you consider this maybe the dual basis of this basis. I don't remember. There is a kind of dual basis thing. So here you have product. I don't remember the details why you have this equality, but it may not be complicated. It's not just a question of a dual basis or something like that. Basis, dual basis. If I take one more second, if I can p equal that, p hat. No. Yeah. Well, here I am just completely stupid. This is p hat. So have p hat, okay. So it decompose. So this is not this one, but yeah, it's exactly the analogous of that in the sense that the coefficient of decomposition of that is that exactly the same way that the coefficient of decomposition of that is this one. Because you have the this is a because you have a question, this is a notion of dual basis. So this is that. That there is nothing mysterious here. Okay. Now you take an abelian normalized by a pair group, then this product is equal. So this proposition is saying that this is zero out of the non-vanishing element, and for the non-vanishing element, it is this determinant. Okay. So this is what I said by the linear when I was a bit confused. This is as the basis, dual basis property. You use exactly the same way here as or before. Okay, so what is the proof? The proof is there. So let me catch some ideas. So you key. So we will use this equality. Okay. So you have that. The determinant. As I said, the determinant is a product. Determinant of that is a product of the eigenvalue. So you will be able to reformulate. Yeah, so it's okay. You just need to consider product of eigenvalue, and then you consider the product of the linear character, apply on that. So this correspond product of eigenvalue, so it's okay. It follow that, yeah, so it's okay. The idea is to say that determinant is product of eigenvalue, and the eigenvalue are the entry of the colon corresponding to the linear character, etc. So you play with the idea of a character table. Okay. Okay. Dually, so you can apply the same thing for the dual hypergroup. So you have the dual hypergroup. You have the vanishing and non-vanishing on the dual. And here, and vanishing mean there exists a standard element on which the linear character vanish. Okay. And proposition four implies the following. So, what was proposition four one? This one. So I guess you can apply this in the next proposition will be the same thing in the dual. Okay. So before you have product of linear character and a determinant of an operator for the standard element in the basis. And here the linear primitive central idempotent. For the dual, you have the primitive central idempotent of the hypergroup, the determinant of the left multiplication for the linear character, and the product of this thing. So this is the same. Okay, so recall the definition of an abelian Bernstein hypergroup from definition. So what was this definition? Yeah, so the definition is like that. An abelian Bernstein hypergroup is an hypergroup in which non-vanishing is equivalent to group like. This is, if you take this definition and you reformulate it with this proposition, you can reformulate the definition of Bernstein as to be group-like. A standard element is group-like if and only if it is non-vanishing. Okay. So, you take an abelian normalizable hypergroup. It is Bernstein if and only if this product is like that. So remember that Bernstein mean B1 is that. So Bernstein mean that here you can write group like. But remember that the determinant in the group like case is what we call the signature. So it's immediate that in the Bernstein case, you have that. You have the group-like element signature, so it's immediate. And you get, in fact, the dual version. I guess this is, no, not yet. Not yet dual version. You get that. Okay, here you have a sign and you are not happy with this sign. But this is a primitive central idempotent. So when you make a square of that, the ij will be zero. So you get the square. So the square of that corresponds to get the square here. So you get one. So the square is something with one. So an abelian normalizable hypergroup is Bernstein differently if the square of the product of the linear character is just the sum of the primitive central idempotent corresponding to the group-like element. Okay. And now, yeah. So this corollary is just saying that when the group of group-like element is of odd order, then we already know that the signature are always one. So we don't need to take a square for an odd group. The signature is always one. So you have this equality with a one directly without taking a square. So it's also immediate. So there is a, you have to deal a bit with, you have to be careful why it's in the odd order you. I skip that, but it's okay. Okay, so this was for Bernstein. So Bernstein, we have the nice reformulation, non-vanishing equivalent to group-like. You can You have a nice reformulation also in terms of product of linear character. So you can apply all these nice things to the dual. And an abelian normalizable hypergroup will be called dual Bernstein if in the dual, the group like elements are exactly the non vanishing element. In other words, this is non zero for I if and only this is group like. Okay. And you can state the dual version of all these corollaries. So dual Bernstein is equivalent to this kind of product equal to this sum with this sign, primitive central idempotent, group like element, etc. If you have the square, you remove the sign. If it is of odd order, you need to take the square, it's already one. Okay. Done. So now we will consider inequalities involving these two products. So remember, these two products was the product we use to reformulate the Bernstein property, dual Bernstein and Bernstein property. You have an equality involving this product. And okay. So you take an abelian normalizable hypergroup satisfying the assumption of lemma 228, which is as usual. The hypergroup is real and negative, and the linear character corresponding to normalizable is a Frobenius power dimension, or the dual is real and negative. Then the complex modulus of this p hat applied to a normalized standard element is always less than or equal to 1. So it looks like a bit of something we already did before involving this kind of inequalities for the formal codegree. And in fact, the proof should be quite similar. So you have that, and the equality all if and only if, I did not read this part. So you have that, and this is equal if and only if this is group like. Okay. Okay. So you have this. So this is immediate because this is a product of that, but we know that this DI is a specific linear character, the Frobenius power dimension linear character, which by Frobenius power theory dominate everything. So this is immediate. Okay. Then when you make the product, you get also greater the product of something less than one is also less than one. And the equality hold if and only if every component is one. So if and only if you have the square modulus of that is for Frobenius power dimension, which is the definition of group like here, or reformulation in this lemma. Okay, so we get one way. So this was the proof for this case. And then we have the same proof for this case. Suppose it's real negative, so I will skip. I guess this is more or less the same idea. Okay. So you take an abelian normalizable hypergroup, then the square of the product of the linear character is an idempotent if and only if this is plus or minus one for all elements, for all non-vanishing standard elements. Otherwise, it should be zero, so you should be careful. Okay. Okay, so what the proof is there? So let me see if there is something complicated. We decompose as we did before. So as I said, the equation. So this, the square is idempotent, not this one. So you have talking, so idempotent is x square equal x, so the root is 0 or 1. So you get, at the end, you get something x square equals 0, so it's 0. S square equal 1, so you get plus or minus 1. It's the idea is only that. Okay, so now you take an abelian normalizable hypergroup satisfying the same kind of property, same kind of assumption, this or this, again, and in fact, this will be used several times. So this is done. Is it done? Oh, where I am? Yeah. Here. Then, okay. So then here we said it's an idempotent if only we have that. And in the corner, we say it's an idempotent if only if it is Bernstein. So this corollary is just saying that Bernstein is equivalent to that for under this assumption. Okay. And the proof is not complicated. So remember that Burnside is equivalent to this equal this. We already know that this is included in this, I guess, or the other way around, I don't remember. This is included in this. Yeah. We know that this is included in this, so we only need to prove that. Okay. Okay. So we deduce that from the fact that this is idempotent. Yeah. Yeah, you have some this something about yeah. Yeah, so you use some previous results. So it, I guess the proof is really, really easy to read. Okay, now you consider an abelian normalizable hypergroup. You consider this usual product. Then you have this decomposition as usual. So you have because these are dual linear dual basis, so you can decompose like that. So you can have the dual version of that. So okay, so I don't remember why I wrote that. Maybe it was to explain something, I don't remember. So you can get a dual version of the three last result. Okay. So first, you have this kind of inequality. Here, the product is inside. In the previous result, the product was outside with a basic standard element here. But similarly, you have this inequality, which all if only if this is group-like. Okay. And this is idempotent if only if you have this plus or minus one on the non-vanishing element. And then this is an idempotent, is equivalent to dual Bernstein. So you can again reformulate Bernstein and dual Bernstein involving this P, but now it's saying that P square or PR square are idempotent. So it's another way to reformulate Bernstein and dual Bernstein involving this element P and P hat. Okay. So now, the analog of Bernstein theorem. What I am talking about. the analog of Bjørn-Bjørnsson theorem, will prove the following generalization of theorem 1, 2. Okay. So here, this is the statement which generalizes the theorem proved by Bernstein 100 years ago, which was also, so the proof will follow the line of the proof in this previous paper by Sébastien Bourtiou. But here we will prove something for hypergroup, and we will use this H-integral dual assumption, which is of course true for the hypergroup, which is the character ring of a group. So in particular, you recover the Burnside result of 100 years ago. So this is this kind of extra assumption we need to be able to prove Burnside theorem. Okay, so you take an abelian rational normalizable hypergroup with H-integral dual. Remember, H-integral dual mean that this is a positive integer. This is a dual fusion coefficient. So you take that, you consider so maybe the Bernstein theorem generalized will not be exactly this one, but will be later. I don't remember. Maybe this one. Maybe later. So you take an abelian rational normalizable hypergroup with H integral dual. You take a standard element. Then, if this is strictly greater than one, then, and this is an algebraic integer, okay, then this is a vanishing element. So you have a zero. Yeah, so this is really the Bernstein theorem. Remember, Bernstein theorem was saying that you have a group, you have the character table, you have the irreducible character, and the one where it's, the degree is not one, you will get a zero in this row. Zero means vanishing element. So there exists a zero in the row corresponding to this standard element. Okay? And this is, this corresponds to the fact that this generalizes the fact that the degree is not one. And I don't remember why we need this assumption, but maybe because it involves algebraic integer. Because this should correspond to some Galois argument, or because here, okay, anyway, this is obviously true for group case, for the character ring of a group. So this, I guess we don't need this assumption for the group case, and maybe for the fusion ring case, we also don't need this assumption. It's always an algebraic integer. And for hypergroup, it's not clear to me you really need this assumption, in fact. Algebraic integer, maybe it may not be. It's always an algebraic number, I guess. Because it's rational here, not an integer. So it's always, I guess this is always an algebraic number, but not always an algebraic integer, maybe. So we need these two assumptions, and then you get a non-vanishing element here. Okay. So I guess the proof will be quite long. So, in fact, yeah, I need two sessions, so the proof is not finished. Let me go up to the end of the proof. Here you need some Galois theory here. In fact, we introduce Galois theory as a preliminary, so you a fortiori you need it in the yeah, so wow. Yeah, the proof is finished here. So of course I will not go into the details of all this proof. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 slide. The proof is quite long, so it's one of the main results of the course, which was proven details last semester. Okay. So what should I say? Let me have a look if I have some idea I can say. So here you are considering this kind of index. So you are fixing a standard element and you consider all linear character will vanish. So it's not, it's a little bit more subtle than the index for the vanishing element. So you, because it's specific to this one. I guess that, okay. Yeah, so I cannot go into the details. It will make too much time. Use the second orthogonality relation. Yeah, okay. We need to show this is non-zero. We need to show this is not, yeah, of course, this is exactly the reformulation of the statement. There exists an I for this non-zero, so we need to show this set is non-zero. So I'm sorry, I have to skip because it make too much time. But if you did not attend it the last semester, this is one of the most important, one of the main results of the course. So I encourage you to watch the last video or to of last semester or to read the paper, read the proof in the paper. So you see there are some tricky aspects. Now I remember a bit. We use really, this proof is tricky. We use a tricky reformulation of something to, and this complicated thing, which is a complicated, is a component of a complicated way to rewrite something, this we can prove it is a positive. So there is a, the proof is really tricky. There is a trick. The proof cannot be done. And here there's another trick. As I said, you have the algebraic mean, geometric mean. So you use and in fact, the algebraic mean, geometric mean, which is used here, is really a generalized version. It's not just you really need the weight, the weighted algebraic mean, geometric mean inequality, because you have some weight here. In the usual way, there is no weight. It's a one everywhere. So you get this kind of inequality. So it's tricky. The proof is. The proof is, in some sense, elementary, but it's really tricky. You have a lot of tricks. And finally, you use Galois theory. So this proof is really nice. This proof contains a lot of tools coming from different areas of mathematics. You have an inequality, and then you have Galois theory. So Galois theory is something really algebraic. And this is really analytic. You have a kind of inequality. And this proof, in some sense, you have a intersect these two theories. You use both. So this is interesting. So the proof is really interesting. So here you apply Galois theory. So okay. So okay, so it finished here. So it's the proof is interesting for itself. Okay, so okay, so why the theorem we stated in the introduction follow from this theorem here? Because of In the introduction, we stated the theorem for the fusion ring case. In the fusion ring case, you have all these assumptions. As I said, this is one, as I said, is always an algebraic integer. It's well known. So no problem, because the fusion coefficients are integer. So it must be an algebraic integer. Okay. So, what about now? You take a rational abelian real non-negative hypergroup. So this is another abbreviation. Usually we wrote real negative abelian, but now ERN for abelian real non-negative. Which H integral do you have? You take an invertible standard element. So let's satisfying equation 4.11, which is I don't remember. So what is the page here? 103. So let me come back to 4.11. 4.16. So we are far. Should write it should be by there, I'm not mistaken. 4.11. Hopefully I wrote it. No, 4.9. Okay, so by there, 4.10. Okay, we are close. 4.11. Okay. So 4.11 is about this is an algebraic integer. I was in 104, if I'm not mistaken. 405. Okay. So you have this proposition is saying so you have a standard element which is invertible. And satisfying this algebraic integer property for all the linear character, then it must be group-like. Okay. So if it is not group-like, then with the reformulation of not group-like, which is there. So you use, in fact, you use Bernstein, I guess you use the Bernstein theorem. Use Bernstein theorem to get a contradiction. Okay. Okay, so now you take a rational abelian real non-negative hypergroup with H integral dual, such that your equation, so the same equation, so algebraic integer equation hold. For all standard elements and for all linear characters, which mean that this means that the character table is made, all the entries are algebraic integer. Remember that this is true, always true for linear, for fusion ring, but may not be true for this case. But I expect, I am almost sure that this is always, the entries are always algebraic numbers. So this is just saying that algebraic integers. So the problem is because the rational may not be integer. Okay. So, if you have all these algebraic integers satisfied and H integral dual satisfied, then it implies it is Bernstein. Okay. So remember, Bernstein is equivalent to that. Non-vanishing corresponds to invertible. And so it comes from this last proposition, which is an application of the big result. So enough to show that. Yeah, so it's immediate. Now, you take a commutative fusion ring. So a commutative fusion ring. with H integral dual is Bernstein. Okay, so it's immediate from before because the commutative fusion ring with H integral dual satisfies all these properties. So it is Bernstein, all the properties here. And so the following corollary here recover the previous result due to Sebastian Bourdieu. But now the proof, maybe the proof here was quite long, but now you can get it as a straightforward application of what we did before. Any commutative Grothendieck ring of any weakly integral fusion category. So here we don't need to any. The commutative fusion Grothendieck ring of any weakly integral fusion category is Bernstein. Let me fix. To put two any, it's too much. The commutative fusion Grothendieck ring of any weakly integral fusion category is Bernstein. Okay. Okay. So here we needed H integral assumption, H integral dual assumption. But remember that we proved that weakly integral fusion category is always H integral dual. So we have all the assumptions of the previous corollary, and so it's Bernstein. Commutative Grothendieck ring of any weakly integral fusion category is Bernstein. Okay. And now we are closer and closer to this arithmetic property we are interested in. Okay, so now we can write a dual version of theorem one. Oh, it's almost time. What is the time? 1 week. Yeah, so I will stop here. Now we will. So next time we will write, we will consider dual version of this main theorem. I guess this is the main theorem. And this will involve dual Bernstein or. Yeah. This will be the last statement of the section. And then we will go to section 5, kernel of fusion ring Brouwer's theorem. Okay, so I will stop here. See you next week if there is no.